Hello! Today I'll be going over how I made this billiard set in Unity. It's an example of making 3D models, importing them into Unity, and adding some physics interactions. Try out the demo at the website in the description. You're welcome to check out the GitHub project as well. To start off, what would a game of pool be without a table? I've seen a pool table before. It has a softball playing area, some bumpers, six pockets with four at the corners and two at the sides. I tried making one in Blender from this picture in my head, but it just didn't look right. So I did what I should have done in the first place and brought up some reference images. After looking at these images, I remembered pool as a somewhat professional sport with actual measurements and specifications for the tables, so I got some schematics and started copying numbers. Key information to remember: the corner pockets have an opening of 4.5 inches, while the side pockets have an opening of about 5 inches. I didn't know this at the time, but this specification would be a source of much more pain for past me soon. A pool table has two lines of symmetry. The sides are mirror images of each other. Blender has a modifier to mirror a model across different axes to make the job of creating models of symmetry much easier. After I remembered how the modifiers worked and spent way too long lining things up, I finally had my basic square. How hard could the rest be? Now, you might notice something off about the pool table. It has no pockets. So I went through about 4 different iterations, slowly learning more about how making 3D models works. Initially, I thought that I could just cut a hole in the mesh by removing the face and moving the vertices around. One problem: I don't know how to make a circle manually. But then I remember that Blender has modifiers that will add or subtract two objects together. I thought I had my solution: make some shapes with pocket holes and cut them out of the surface. Then make the holes for the openings in the bumpers and continue cutting. It looked great at first to modify my basic mesh, but then I realized getting the two meshes to line up was difficult and took a lot more time than expected. Now, I realized adding those cutout shapes and modeling by hand was probably not the best way to go about this. It left some jagged edges and caused a lot of problems with the geometry. That extra work was unnecessary, so I decided to start modeling process again with the bumpers and surface as one piece and cut the holes in one shape to make sure it lines up properly and is flush together. Voila, a perfect looking pool table, and it's... Oh wait. When I applied the smooth shading modifier, the shading gets all whack around where the holes are cut in the mesh. That's not good. And when I added a subdivision modifier to enhance the resolution and smooth out the mesh, it created even more problems. Okay, so that method of Boolean modifier is out for now. Let's try using the loop tools add-on in Blender. Cut out the holes manually like at the start, and then use this nifty circle modifier to move all the vertices into a circle. With some manual adjusting, I could get it to look right. Ah, the pool table is complete and great now. Let's just compare it to the schematic and see how it looks. Oh wait, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It seems like I've added an extra set of side pockets to my pool table. Okay, this video is running over time. I'll have to get into this more later. I basically fixed all these issues by starting the pool table again from scratch and cut the table into three main parts: the surface, the bumpers and edges, and the corner pockets. Each of these parts are their own mesh, and I might make a follow-up video with more details about how I modeled this from schematics in Blender and what modifiers I used as part of the design process. It's elegant and has helped me learn a lot more about Blender as a whole. Now that I can finally have this done, let's move on to the rest of the project. Next is to paint the pool table. I could do some complex UV mapping and make a pretty pattern or image on the model, or just make two separate materials for the felt, wood, and pockets and assign each face of the model to their respective materials accordingly. We can just make these solid colors for now. Adding a fun image will take a bit more time. Import it into Unity, set up the materials, get the lighting just right, and perfect! We're still missing something. That's right, the pool balls! So thankfully, Unity comes with some built-in pool balls for us. Look at those colorless spheres. Make a material color or two, add a rigid body, and then move around, activate the scene, and... Oh, they fell right through the table. Why did that happen? Well, I forgot to tell Unity that the pool table is solid and not just made of air. We need to call the code to generate a collider for the pool table in its import settings, and Unity will then allow other objects to hit the pool table. After applying these import settings, Unity will generate a mesh for our table and allow us to have the pool balls hit them and each other. The pool table is static and the pool balls are dynamic physics objects. To learn more about the different kinds of physics objects in games, look at my previous video on how physics works for character controllers, linked to the card in the top right. Alright, so now that we have our basic pool balls moving around, it would be nice to number them. Although, how do you draw an image on a sphere? It's not like we can just paint on the number and expect it to work. Well, the sphere in Unity is a basic UV sphere that uses UV mapping to draw an image onto the sphere. The projection used in Unity is a cylindrical projection, which is like taking an image, printing it out on a piece of paper, and wrapping it around the sphere as a cylinder. It's like a Mercator projection that you would see on any world map in a school classroom. This is a basic UV sphere. You might notice that there's some stretching at the sides of the poles though, but we don't care about this for pool balls because they only have a number and solid color for them on for the most part. Alright, so now that we know how to make our UV sphere works, we just have to add an image for our pool balls for each number, right? You can find these basic images online, but I can't just take it from the internet and use it. Unless it's open source like my project, link in the description. So each of these pool balls has a really similar pattern, right? A color, a stripe, a circled number in the middle. Those patterns are pretty simple. Any combination of those few attributes could describe a pool ball. Give it a color, a stripe, and a number. Hence, I decided to make a procedural pool ball image to achieve this. Besides, why spend an hour doing something once when I could spend 10 hours failing to automate it? So, step one of the shader, procedural color. That's easy. Plug a color into our output node, done. Step two, optional stripe. This one's a bit more difficult, but I can use a previous project that I worked on to recolor images. I simply have an image of a black stripe and recolor the part of the ball and the rest of the part, the white stripe. Look at my video linked at the card in the top right about recoloring images if you're interested to learn more about how that works. In our shader, we can simply use my Combine Images shader to combine the colors following the pattern defined by the stripe image. See how when we look at the 3D object, it wraps nicely around the ball following the cylindrical projection? Step 3, adding the circled number. This one was a bit more difficult. First, we need to draw a small circle that's some off-white color as the stripe. We then take this simple circle image, and I make it a combination of the previous striped image to add the small circle in the center. Next, and more difficult part, is adding the numbers. I used Inkscape to do this one and spent way too long trying to send in the numbers to make sure they fit inside the circle image I made earlier. But after some time, I had these nice images to show off. Look at those digits. Did you ever notice how the one on pool balls looks rounded like that? I couldn't find a font to do that already had that, and I spent far too long centering the text and finding just the right font size. So I decided to use the letter L as it looked close enough in the picture and just like all those fancy pool balls you see in real life. Extra step, 3.5, drawing the numbers. Repeat the same process that we did to draw the circle on the pool balls to draw the numbers on top of the image. Now we have a real looking pool ball. Just make a few materials, get the colors just right, and apply them to the pool balls. Oh wait, that doesn't look right. These numbers look way too stretched, and they're only on one side of the ball? I was scratching my head to figure out what happened. Then, I remembered the numbers was only one half the pool ball image. If we wrapped a piece of paper with only one number on it, around the ball, it would be all stretched like we see here. But if we tape two pieces of paper together and wrap them around, we get a front and back of the ball. We can achieve this by just tying the image twice with this sample texture 2D node, and those pool balls look right. Put them all together and add a little bit of shine, arrange them nicely. Wow, that looks like a real pool set. Or at least as real as I can do in this limited time anyway. Now that we have the pool balls together, we need to place them in a pool ball pattern. I could manually move them around the editor to their exact positions or use a FMX simulation with a wooden triangle, but why do something manually when you can automate it? Do you see that? In the pool ball layout, they're almost like a hexagon grid. I have another project kicking around with a generic hexagon code. Let's look at that project and try placing the pool balls in those positions. Just need to write a little code to automatically generate the list of positions in the hex grid shown before, place a ball at each position on the grid, get it wrong, an embarrassingly wrong number of times. I had to account for the fact that my hex grid code is defined as XY coordinate plane instead of rows by columns. Also, I need to center it at 0, 0 and account for the offset in the grid. Once we had the grid ready, we need to make sure that we place the 8 ball in the correct position and rotate all the balls so that they face the right direction. Making these playing in an interactive environment with a pool cue would take quite a bit of extra work, For right now, I just implemented a small sphere that follows your mouse around the map, hitting things as it moves around. We can do this by measuring where your mouse is each frame, then moving the player object towards that at some fixed speed. It's not too complicated, but does require a few steps to get working just right. And we need a measure to make sure we don't overshoot where the mouse actually is. Unity has a nice function to convert where the mouse is on the screen to where it is in the game, and can lead to a very smooth result we see here. The red object is the target where your mouse is, and the white object is the ball that can hit things. And simulating collisions is hard, so we'll just ignore that for now and let the ball walk through walls of the pool table as a kinematic object. In addition, I'll add a button to the game menu that resets the position of the pool balls whenever the player presses it. We also need to disable that script for moving the player around when the menu is open. We don't want to accidentally move the player when the menu's open. Final touch is to add a script to allow for rebinding of inputs. I'll cover this in a later video. The script is quite complicated and this video is too long already. In the future, we will expand the project in many ways, like adding sounds when the objects collide, adding an actual pool cue, maybe some scores, and possibly multiplayer. You can check out the current demo at the website linked in the description, and feel free to leave some comments or suggestions on the GitHub project if you have any fun ideas. I'll keep on updating this project along with my character controller project. They both use a lot of the same concept, and a similar pool set will serve as a nice example that is easier to understand than a complex character controller, so I'll keep updating both for now. I hope you liked this video. I'm cutting a bit short of all the things I'd like to add, but avoiding scope creep is important. Been more busy than expected this holiday season. I know I mentioned the code is open source before. This means that if you want to, you can submit a code change, open an issue for an error, or submit a feature request. If you add something interesting, I would love to highlight it in a future video topic. Thanks for watching and listening. Have a great day!